dating a girl at the time. We had not kissed. And it's okay to date and not kiss, okay? So we hadn't kissed at the time, but I'm being a typical guy. I'm acting like I've kissed all these girls. I'm lying. And I'm trying to be confident. And so we decided we were going to have our first kiss. And it was going to be after school. Her friends found out about it. My friends found out about it. It seemed like the whole school did. So after school, it was right in Webster Middle School. I walked home because I stayed across the street. The bus picked her up. And so we're standing there in front of each other. Everybody's watching. It's like an after school fight. I'm thinking on the outside. I'm calm and I'm cool and I'm collected. I'm just looking at her like, it's going to be all right. You know, I'm just playing girls. It's just cool. But on the inside, she grabbed her stuff, ran on the bus crying, and that was one of the longest walks home I would say I've ever had. Now, on a more serious note, I know that some of you have had personal failures or past experience that are a lot more serious than that. I mean, for some of you, it could have been a divorce that you have just recently gone through, or maybe even in the past, a while back. Or it could be some sexual addiction. You promised God, I'm not going to do this again, God, but you end up doing it again. Or you make a promise to yourself, I will never do this. You end up doing the same thing. Or maybe it was a time in your life, there was some injustice going on, and you saw it. You said, I'm going to do something about it. I'm not going to let that happen on my watch. But you stood back. You sat down and did nothing. And I would say, whatever the end of the spectrum that you're on, concerning your past failures, I want you to remember point number one. It says your biggest sins are not too big for God's grace.
Amen.
Your biggest sins are not too big for God's grace. And I love it. The Apostle Paul wrote to the Christian churches in Rome, and he wrote to the people. He said, where sin increased, grace increased all the more. The definition of grace in simple terms is to be given something that we do not deserve. We don't deserve it, but God gives it to us. And Paul told those churches that as the people continue to sin, God continued to show more and more grace. But you might be saying, well, Abraham, I feel guilty. Good! Guilt! It's not necessarily a bad thing. Guilt shows that your heart is still alive. It's a bad thing when you do wrong and you feel no guilt, no remorse. That's a problem. Guilt shows that your heart is still alive, that God can still alarm you. And I would say that guilt has one purpose and one purpose only. It's to drive you back to God, to drive you to repentance.
That's right.
Now, God stands ready to forgive if only we'll come. And I love it how 1 John 1:9 will be on the screen. It says that if, everybody say if.
If
we confess our sins, God is faithful and just. And everybody say it with me. And will
forgive us our sins
and purify us from all unrighteousness. In summary, this is what Paul is saying. If we confess, God will forgive. We have a part, God has a part. You can't have one without the other. If you confess your sins, God will wipe your slate clean. Now, has anybody even heard of an Etch-a-Sketch? Anybody? Etch-a-Sketch? Now, people in Arkansas like a laptop computer. I'm not sure. But I told my mom to go get me one. It's usually red. It's a little bit bigger. But this is the one she got. And notice, we still kept it in the package. I am taking this back, getting my money back. But the purpose of this Etch-a-Sketch, okay? You try to draw something that you like, right? And when you mess up, what do?
Shake it, erase it.
You shake it, and it's clean. And then you might try to get, I remember my niece and nephews, I was over there, and they have one. They try to draw something. Oh, Abraham, I'm going to draw you a gun. I'm like, what are you, don't draw a gun. It's all printed. They draw something, they mess up, they shake it, it's clean. And I would say that's the same way with God. We go out in life, we're trying to do the right thing, and we mess up. Instead of suppressing it, we need to go ahead and confess it. Go to God, say, God, I messed up back then. I'm sorry about that. It's like he picks us up, clean. You know, and then you go forward, say, okay, God, I'm going to okay, I got my head on straight. Somebody cuts you off in traffic, or somebody makes you mad at work. What do you do? Hey, buddy, I'm gonna rip you a good. Then you're like, ah, that's not Christ-like. You go to God, God, I'm sorry about that. I shouldn't have been acting like that. Clean. Just like this Etch-a-Sketch, God stands ready to forgive us.
That's
If only we'll confess our sin. I love how the prophet Jeremiah put it, speaking on behalf of our personal failures. Jeremiah speaking to the people on God's behalf, and listen to these words in Jeremiah 31, 34. He says, for I will forgive their wickedness. And everybody say it with me. And he'll what?
Remember their sins no more.
No more. Amen. Once God has forgiven you, he will not remember your sins anymore. That's what it says. In fact, the Bible says that God has removed our sins. Listen to this. As far as the east is from the west. Well, you might be saying, how far is the east is from the west? In the famous words of Buzz Lightyear, to infinity and beyond. It's far. The east and west. God has removed our sins as far as the east is from the west. And I would say this. If God has forgotten your sins, if God has already forgiven you, it's time to forgive yourself.
Amen.
You know, we need to learn to let things go. And you know the funny thing about the past? It's in the past. You can't do anything about it. The past is behind us. And like Craig said, every saint has a past and every sinner has a future. Now, I remember something that was kind of hard for me to let go. I went to college at the University of Colorado, you know, played football up there. Now, while I was up there, I was baptized when I was a young boy, 9 years old. I believe I was saved. But for some reason, I didn't remember it as much. So when I was in church, I went to a Church of Christ, very traditional. And so the pastor, at the end of the service, would stand in front, and he would give what's called an altar call. And so an altar call is where you would have to come down to the front, whether you wanted to be saved or baptized. It didn't matter. So he would stand there, say, anybody else, anybody wants to come. And people normally know me as a radical. You know, I'm just so excited about God. I'll do anything. I'll stand on the streets. But for some reason, I sat in the back of that church week after week after month after month, and I could not get out of my seat. I wanted to be baptized, not for my salvation, but just to boldly proclaim that I follow Christ. I didn't really remember when I was younger. I just wanted to do it again. But I did not have the guts. And so when we were doing a Monday night Bible study, with my pastor, he ended up finding out that I wanted to be baptized. So he opened up the church. We went there, and I got baptized that night. After I got baptized, I pulled him to the side. I said, thank you. I've been wanting to do this for months, and I just sat in my seat like a coward. Thank you for doing that. He looked at me, and he said, well, you know what, Abram? You are a coward. Whoa, brother, if I wasn't a Christian, but he's the man of God, he's a pastor. You know what? I said, I'm waiting on a response, but he told me, as he called me a coward, messing stuff up, I'm sorry. As he called me a coward, this is what he said. Abraham, God has already forgiven you. Before you've even asked him, he's already forgiven you. And he said, it's time to just get over it. Don't live under that. I know you didn't take that chance when you should have went down to the church, but you're baptized and God has already forgiven you before you even asked him. And I would say this, just like my pastor called me a coward, I had a similar experience my rookie year with the Dolphins. Now, after college, I played my rookie year with the Miami Dolphins. You got any Dolphins fans? Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Honestly, I'm not a Dolphins fan anymore because they left, so we're even. Yeah. Dolphins, my rookie year. I mean, I was in the NFL. I went in kind of preface this. I want you to know it was a lot going on. I was a rookie, had a lot on my mind. Okay, I'm stepping into this big platform. Now, when I got there, I just made a lot of mistakes, just unknowingly. I just did things, and the coaches would tell me, "Hey, Abram, go get those green cones." I come back with the red bats. And so, since I'm a rookie, the veterans had the right to tell us to do stuff. They said, Abram, go give me a granola bar. I come back with some scrambled eggs. I didn't know. I just made mistakes. And I can remember this one teammate in particular. I'm not going to say his name, just in case if he finds out through one of y'all. He's a pretty big guy. But he developed a nickname for me. Can't get right. And I think it's off the movie Life or something like that. I don't know my last name is right. But they developed a nickname, Can't Get Right. So when he would see me and I would come in, he'd say, Can't get right. What's up, boy? I said, what's up? I didn't think nothing of it. It was just something small. I come the next day, same thing. Hey, what's up, can't get right? Then before you know it, other players started calling me, can't get right. Then the coaches started calling me, can't get right. By the end of the season, coaches, trainers, everybody knew me as
can't get right.
That's what they called me. And I was thinking, I'm not can't get right. I'm not defined by my past failures. I'm not can't get right. I'm who God says I am. That's point number two. You are not what you have done. You are who God says you are.
Amen.
And just like they called me can't get right or a coward like my pastor did, maybe you called yourself some names, or maybe people call you some things. Maybe you've lost your virginity and you feel like I'm used goods, eh? I don't think I'm going to find a guy to treat me like a princess, or I've just blown it. Or maybe you failed the ACT. You're trying to go to college. You didn't make the cut. Now you're saying, hey, I'm not that smart. I'm stupid. Let me tell you this. I think, Mom, I'm sorry. I think I made a 12 or 11 on my ACT. And I got a bachelor's degree. I'm preaching at my church. Don't tell me you're defined by your past failures.
Right. Woo! Right. Right.
Maybe you can tell you, and I say this with my mind permission, maybe you've gone through a divorce. And it hurts, okay? And I'm going to tell you, coming from my mom with her permission, she's gone through two. And I'm going to tell you this. She leads a divorce care class, mentoring other women who've gone through it. And she looks and talks more like Christ than I've ever seen. I believe she's getting ready to step into full-time ministry. Don't tell me you're defined by your past failures.
That's right.
You are not what you've done. You are who God says you are. Now, God says, if you didn't know, you're an overcomer. You are an overcomer through the blood of the Lamb, which is Jesus Christ, and the words of our testimony. You are an overcomer. The Bible says you are more than a conqueror through Christ Jesus. The Bible says you are a friend of God. The Bible says you are the bride of Christ. Amen. You're a child of God. You're not what you've done. You're who God says you are. I want you to listen to what Paul said, what we are as followers of Christ, no longer living under our personal failures. 2 Corinthians 5:17. It says that anyone who belongs to Christ has become a, everybody say it with me, has become a
new person.
The old life is gone. A new life
has begun.
Basically, what Paul is saying is that we don't have to live under our personal failures. And I will tell you that this is good news for me, because I had a personal failure that was pretty hard for me to get over. My mom, through her second marriage, she got remarried. I believe I was about 10 or 11 at the time. And my stepdad was verbally and physically abusive a few times. Now, I can remember at that time, being in the house with my mom and my little sister, I just wanted to protect my mom. I don't know if it's just something that's in a guy. You just want to be the man. And you might be saying, well, Abraham, you were just a little boy. Don't tell me that. I don't know if it's just men and men might know. You just want to be the protector of your home. And so when my stepdad would go on these tyrants, I would sit there like a coward. I was so scared out of my mind. I remember feeling so ashamed, and I held on to that for years. Maybe that's why I got into football, and I worked out so hard. I wanted to prove to my stepdad and to the world that I'm a man, and I hated seeing my mom and that family and that household go through just drama, and I was scared out of my mind. I didn't want to tell anybody, and I will tell you that even though I felt like I failed my mom as a protector of our home, I had to realize there's truth in Christ. There is truth in Christ. I want you to hear it. It says that failure is never a person. It's an event. And just because you failed at something, that doesn't mean you're a failure. I want you to think back my seventh grade when I ducked when that girl was trying to kiss me, and I was ashamed. I was embarrassed because my friends found out I was prude. The reality is I hadn't kissed the girl. And I will tell you, that same boy that ducked, that was ashamed, not wanting his friends to find out that I was really prude and did not want to kiss a girl, now stand before he has a 26-year-old guy with a purity ring. Yes, guys, I know this for a 13-year-old girl, but I have a purity ring, and I vow, through my brother's help, to never kiss a girl until I get married anymore. I don't care what people think. I get in locker room to get mad, and I would even say to God that was ashamed to get baptized or come before the church. I was embarrassed. Didn't want to do it. I'm now with my roommate and other groups of people. We stand on 240 and Walker with signs. Some of you have seen us saying, Jesus Christ died for your sins. You tried everything else. Try Jesus.
Amen.
We stand out there boldly telling people that Jesus Christ saves and is holding you. Or maybe with the fact of my mom and my sister, I was a little bit scared. I was timid. I didn't protect them. And if you're wondering if I've gotten over that, matter of fact, just mess with my mom and sister today. Matter of fact, just look at them wrong. Just make a little wrong way. I'm not still living under my past failures. I'm not defined by my personal failures, and you shouldn't be either. In Christ, we're a new person. Let's go back to prayer.
Amen.